people plan for this season throughout the whole year, planning for Christmas. Some of you, begin buying gifts that you'll give to others just the week after Christmas, some the day after Christmas, already beginning the preparation for the next Christmas. I don't know about how you feel, but for me, as I get older, it seems Christmas comes quicker and quicker every year. We pulled the decorations out of the attic, and I thought, man, I could have sworn we just put those back up in the attic just a couple days ago, it seemed like. And we were bringing them back out. As I went around, driving around over the last couple weeks, watching various people celebrate Christmas, the thought hits me, and it hits me most every year. I wonder if people really know what they're celebrating. Because there's people that I see that celebrate Christmas, but I know that they don't believe that Jesus is the Savior of the world. And in my heart, I just begin to pray for them. I don't want to condemn them by any means. So I begin to pray that maybe somehow they may receive the light, the revelation of what Christmas is. I love the decorations, the festivity. I love going out to the mall. I don't really like to shop, but I like at Christmas time maybe to go walk in the mall and just see all the various decorations that are out and about. It's just a fun time of the year. But we began a few weeks ago receiving the revelation of what I identified as the true spirit of Christmas. We reflected on that, one of the Christmas carols that we sang a few weeks ago, Hark the Herald the Angels Sing. And some of the great revelation that various Christmas carols offer to us. And they're more than just words that we sing, but they're great inspirations of revelation. This morning, I've just entitled today's message, as we continue with the series, we'll conclude it this upcoming Sunday morning. I've entitled today, the Christ of Christmas. The Christ of Christmas. It's He that we celebrate in this season of Christmas. If you have your Bible, look at Galatians chapter 4. I read this Wednesday, but I'm going to read it again tonight. Pick up with me in the first verse. It says, What I am saying is that as long as there is an heir, the heir is a child. He is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. Verse 2, he is subject to guardians and trustees until the set time by his father. So also, when we were children, we were in slavery under the basic principles of the world. But catch specifically verse 4 and 5. But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has made you also an heir. Father, we say thank you for your word. Lord, help us to gain your truths this morning. Lord, I just specifically ask that you would touch my lips this morning, God, to declare your truth, your words. God, your revelation that you would have in store for us. God, I pray for every heart that's here this morning, Lord, that it be receptive, Lord, to receive your message. Lord, as we're here to honor you and the wonderful name of Jesus, I pray. Look back to verse 4 and 5 one more time, because this is where I really want to draw our attention. It states, but when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive the full rights of son. Imagine this. I began to dive into this a little bit on Wednesday night, but imagine the prophetic messages that were given for hundreds of years in regards to the coming of Jesus Christ. We find a lot of these throughout the whole Old Testament. Some would say, well, you find them in the book of Isaiah. You find them in the book of Jeremiah. Maybe you'll find them in the book of Psalms. I would declare to you that you find the prophetic message of Jesus in every book in the Old Testament, of the coming of the Messiah, the coming of Jesus. And these prophetic words had gone out thousands upon thousands of years before Jesus had come. But simply God was waiting for the right time. And at this moment, he declares that the time has fully come. The time was ripe for the coming of Jesus. Emmanuel, God with us. Some would say, well, what took so long? Well, please understand that God has his time. And God's time is perfect. God's time is the right time. What moments of anticipation that those, the believers, those that we would classify as Christians, were hoping, were waiting, would we be the generations, would we be the ones that would see the coming of Jesus? I believe it's very similar to the anticipation, the hope, the belief that you and I have today. Will we be the generation that sees the return of Jesus Christ? I would declare to you that I believe that we are the generation, that we are the ones that will experience the return of our soon coming King Jesus himself. But I wonder, would we be ready? Because the reality is, though the time was right, not all were ready. Would you be ready when God the Father looks over at his son and says, now's the time? Could it be said again that the time has fully come? So God saw it right to send his son, that we could step into eternity with him. I want to give you two thoughts this morning about the Christ of Christmas. Number one, I believe the Christ of Christmas, from birth to his present status, is a revelation from God, is the completeness of the revelation of God. Let me point out just a few things for you this morning. Thoughts, truths. First of all, in Christ's birth, one can see the power of God to rise above the natural and to manifest himself in a miraculous way. Think of this, the babe in Bethlehem was the greatest miracle of all times. He was the pre-existent one now in the earthly existence. He was the eternal God in the form of a fleshly child. No one but an omnipotent God could do this. The babe in Bethlehem was born of a virgin without an earthly father. He began to dispel what we would recognize as the natural laws. The miracle. Only one who had power would be able to break a natural law and bring into the world as God the one that we recognize as Jesus Christ. The babe in Bethlehem is a proof of God's fulfillment of his prophecy. Hundreds of years, as I made mention of, hundreds, thousands of years before the birth of Jesus, God had promised such an event with many, many specific details completely that were spelled out. This is a revelation of God's knowledge, and I believe his ability to carry out his plans. Once again, in Christ's birth, we can see the power of God to rise above the natural and to manifest himself in a miraculous way. Secondly, in Christ's life, one can see the nature, but also the characteristics of God that are at work. The Bible speaks of God as love. And no greater revelation of love can be found and or manifested than that in Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. What a demonstration of love that we can begin to gain that revelation of the characteristic of the love. This is an all-inclusive, regardless of how many people might be cataloged or characterized. There are no exceptions. All are to be loved of God. That God loves all. Yet while I was a sinner, God loved me. While I was a sinner, Christ died on the cross for me. The love that God has for us. The Bible speaks of God's being no respecter of persons. In the life of Jesus, one can see the validity of such a statement. In him, the worth of each person is over and over again is emphasized. The worth of who we are in the life of Jesus Christ. The Bible also speaks of Jesus as a God of compassion. In his very movements while on earth manifested God as a God of compassion. How he would move from this city to that city. And the Bible would often say, moved by compassion. He would reach out and touch somebody. He would reach out and heal somebody. Moved with compassion, the Bible says, he cried over the city. You see, it's in the life of Christ that we find the fulfillment of the characteristics, the nature of God himself. I believe when God looks at us, we see love. We experience his grace. We receive his compassion into our lives. Thirdly, for you this morning, in Jesus' death, one can see the sacrifice of God to redeem lost people. In Jesus, God died physically and spiritually to pay the price for the sins of the world. The wages of sin, Romans tells us, is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus shed his blood simply for the remission of my sin, yet also the remission of your sins. From the beginning of time, blood sacrifices played a major role in redeeming fallen people, redeeming people from the sins of life. But Jesus came and shed his blood on Calvary once and for all, for the sins of all. You see, it's in the death of Jesus we can begin to understand the sacrifice of God, his desire, his revelation to redeem lost people. Number four for you, in his resurrection, the resurrection of Jesus, in his ascension, in his intercession, one can see God as mighty, as one as ruling, and also one as victorious. The resurrection reveals power over enemy number one, which we recognize is death and the grave. The greatest enemy that we experience, the greatest fear that most experience is the fear of death, is fear of the grave. Yet Jesus overcame that for our lives. When he arose from the grave, we recognize that he broke the power of death and grave. And so he reveals God's power to us. The ascension reveals God's power over time and also over physical laws. The intercession reveals God and his concern for his people of all time. I stand before you this morning. I pray you feel the same way. I say, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for his resurrection. Thank God for his ascension. Thank God for his intercession for our lives. Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews declares that he sits at the right hand of God daily, continuously, making intercession for your life, for my life. I can't think of anybody who I would rather to pray for me than Jesus himself. To believe that he's making intercession. Why? Because he knows your life. He knows your experiences. Before you experience them, I believe God is already praying for you. Number five for you. In Jesus' soon return, his coming again, I believe one can see the cleansing and yet also the ruling Christ, that he would reign. over this world yet again. How beautiful that will be. What an experience. What a day that will be. It's a song we used to all sing, "When my Jesus I shall see." To know that he's coming again. I don't know about you, but I find myself at times just daydreaming about the return of Jesus. Trying to visualize. Why? I know I said, like, because I believe I'm close. I believe we're drawing nigh to the return of Jesus. Sometimes I just lay in bed and just thinking, what is this going to be like? How wonderful. Am I the only one that does such a thing? I wonder, do anybody else? Do you find yourself just dreaming, maybe daydreaming, wondering, thinking about the return of Jesus? I don't know about you, but I get excited when I begin to think about the coming again of Jesus to receive the church, to take us home, to live throughout all eternity with him. How I long for those moments. But we see his power manifested. His ability to rule. You see, because I believe the Christ of Christmas from birth, as I declared, to the present status is a continual revelation of who God is. My second point for you this morning is I believe the Christ of Christmas is worthy of a lofty place in the lives of all people. He's worthy of his rightful place, his lofty place, his exalted position within our lives. Let me identify just a few things of those positions within our lives. Number one, I believe he's worthy of worship. He's worthy of our worship. How beautiful it is when people worship God. How beautiful it is when people worship Jesus. To worship Christ aright, as we declare in spirit and truth, we must surrender our lives to him and for salvation. Then Jesus becomes our personal Savior. And this simply is his purpose for coming into this world. Christ is to be worshiped privately, I believe, in the year round. But he's also to be worshiped publicly in the church throughout the year. Christ is to be worshiped in adoration. Everyone ought to see him as God and Savior and manifest reverent admiration for him. Christ, I believe, is to be worshiped within our praise. All Christians are to praise his name, to praise his works, to praise his love, and to praise him for his redeeming grace. I believe that Christ is to be worshiped in our praise. I wonder this morning, church, is Christ worshiped through your life? Is he adored in your life? You see, I believe Christ is to be exalted because of our love for him and our appreciation for who he is. I often say this, I believe our worship is simply an expression of my love to Jesus. How I worship identifies how I love Jesus. Maybe could I say how much I love Jesus, how much I appreciate who Jesus is and what Christ has done for my life. So he's worthy. He's worthy of our worship. Number two, I believe Christ is worthy of my life and my possessions. He's worthy of my life and my possessions. In him, one's life, I believe, is at its very best. You want the best life? Then put your life in Jesus. He's worthy of my life and my possessions. I believe apart from God, I'm living an inferior life. I believe apart from God, you're living an inferior life. In him is what life ought to be. Apart from him is simply less than what is determined as the best for our lives. In one's possessions in him, one's possessions are sanctified, are cleansed, and I believe are multiplied over and over for the good, that he might use what he has blessed us with for his glory. Have you surrendered your life and your possessions? It's easy, we would say, to surrender our life, but I don't know. I believe my dad was a great example of this. I learned this from him. great, great man. He taught me from a young age that the home that we lived in wasn't simply our home, but that it was God's home. That God had gifted us, and we have a great responsibility to care for this place that we recognize as our shelter, our dwelling. But first and foremost, it was God's. Because of so, at any moment, our home was used for the purposes of God. Dad would often tell the minister, if you ever need a home to use, ours is available because its first is God's. And my dad didn't just say that, but he practiced it. I can't tell you how many times there were events or activities or studies that took place in my home when I grew up. Because to Dad, this was the Lord's. He was surrendering what we would classify as our possessions to the glory of the Lord. I'm so thankful that I can stand before you and that I have that example. Because I've learned to feel the same way about my home. That it's not mine, but it's God's. So if the ladies want to use it, the ladies can use it. If the men want to use it, the men. If the youth, if the children, if it's needed for a study, whatever it's needed for. Because it's first the Lord's. And I believe that my home is to be a light for the goodness of God's. For the greatness of God, and that God is, I believe, strategically placed me there, just as I believe that God has strategically placed you in your home that you might become a witness for the greatness of God, the glory of God, that we could be a light to the world that surrounds us. Why? Because I've surrendered my possessions to the glory of God. You see, because I believe that he deserves his lofty position. I'm not the leader of my home. God is. God's the leader of my home. I'm not the leader of the church. God is the leader of the church. He deserves his lofty positions in every area of our life. Number three for you, I believe Christ is worthy of recognition, but also worthy of consultation by the entire world. Here's what I've learned as I begin to conclude our message this morning. I believe when I began to walk in and to understand the goodness of God, it's natural to want to give recognition to whom recognition is due. Right. So what I'm trying to say is when I understand who God is, it's natural to want to tell others about who he is. I'm recognizing God. When I tell others about Jesus, I believe it's at that moment that I'm recognizing the greatness of God. I believe it's at that moment that I'm recognizing the love of God. I believe it's at that moment that I'm recognizing the grace of God. It's at that moment that I'm recognizing the sacrifice that God has made. I'm wanting to give him recognition for who he is in my life, that I want to make him known to those that I come. It's natural. It's natural. Along with that, I believe when I understand who he is, I believe it's natural to want to consult him. He is wisdom supreme. He knows. He knows all. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are better than our thoughts. If there's somebody that I need to seek counsel from, then who other than God himself? Who other than Jesus Christ? What is that? That's putting him in his lofty position. It's putting him in his rightful position. Why would I run to all the things that the world has to offer me seeking counsel? Why not just run to Jesus and say, Lord, I need some help. Lord, I need some direction. Now, the beautiful thing is God surrounds us with other great people. And I think it's good to have those people. But why not go to Jesus first? why not look to Jesus? You see, when I began to put him in his rightful position, his lofty position, his exalted place, then I naturally want to recognize him. I naturally want to consult him in the experiences of my life. This week, God bless you. So in this Christmas season, in your buying of gifts, in your various celebrations, in your eatings, can I encourage you with this? Don't forget Jesus. Don't forget Jesus. Keep him where he belongs. Keep him as number one, as first, in his exalted position in your life, in your family, in your moments of celebration. Let Christ, as you dwell into his life, continue to receive the revelation of who God is as you choose to celebrate this Christmas. And I've never done this before, but I'm going to give you a different challenge as I conclude the message. It's this time of the year that we love to spend money. Or at least your credit bill says that you love to spend money. I'll put it that way. How about missions? How about the spreading of the gospel? You know, as I draw the conclusion, we receive offerings all throughout the year. Maybe you might feel compelled. And as Brother George says, I just say, I commend you for your faithfulness in giving. But we receive a lot of missions offering. Maybe God might compel you to give just an extra gift as part of your celebration. Maybe to the Gideons for the reproduction of Bibles. Maybe to fire Bibles that we receive every month. Maybe to a missionary. Maybe just being a blessing to somebody else. I mean, we're going to spend a lot of money. A lot of it's going to be open and just forgotten. What about something that's eternal? Amen. Something that has lasting value. Let me encourage you. Just bless a missionary. We have, they wouldn't ask me to do this, but we have, that I know of, a couple missionaries, really a lot of missionaries, but in professional missionaries, sitting in our sanctuary this morning. Kenan and Amanda at Sam Houston State University, ministering to college students. Kristen and Rainier, soon to go back to Madagascar. You know, who knows? Maybe it's the Gideons. Maybe it's the fire. Who knows what God? You may have another thought. But I say this distinctly. God should have a lofty place even in our finances. Because we're surrendering all to him. So in your seeking of joy, because this is the season of joy, could you look to Jesus? Could you trust in Jesus? Because I believe in him, you'll find that supreme joy that you've been looking for.